Good morning, everyone. Ooh, that works. Good morning, everybody. I am Margaret Lowe Smith. I'm the president of Atlantic Live, which is the events division of The Atlantic. I am so impressed with the number of people out here, and I wish I could say I'm so glad to see you on this beautiful spring morning. But I can't. I'm really, really glad to see you. And actually, I did a little data search this morning. This is, in fact, the coldest April 30th in 20 years. So the fact that you're freezing is not surprising. Welcome to the Unfinished Revolution, Women, Fairness, and Power. This Saturday morning edit breakfast has become something of a tradition for the Atlantic media. It's our effort to slide a little substance in with the swirl of the White House Correspondents' Dinner Weekend. It is possible that when we meet here, or somewhere close to here, next year, that there will be a woman in the White House. That was actually not a point of view, that was just a statement of fact. And there's no question that Hillary Clinton's candidacy has rekindled an important conversation about gender equality. And whether there's a woman in the White House or not is just a piece of the story. The U.S. is the only advanced country economy that does not mandate paid maternity leave, not to mention paid paternity leave. And in many industries, women are still paid less, often much less than men, for the same work, from Hollywood to the soccer field, from the boardroom to the factory floor. And another important thing is that the conversation is not just about the role of women, is not just about women. It's actually about all of us. It's not about women and girls, it's about all of our lives, it's about our families, the way we interact at work, at home. It's about men, about our brothers and fathers, husbands and sons, and about their experience too. So, on that note, a quick video from PYPO, short for Put Your Pretty On, to help fuel our conversation. Hit the tape.
Hey babe, have you seen my feminism?
Your what?
My feminism. I could have swore I left it on the sink.
Oh shit, wait, but that little white pill?
Yeah.
I thought that was an aspirin.
You took my feminism?
Oh shit. Wait. What happens when a man takes feminism? Is it dangerous?
Well, who cares?
I care.
Look, I care.
I
have to take that pill every day to maintain healthy levels of feminism. If women don't take what's ours, other people will take it from us.
I just...
Of course. I turn my back for 1 second, a man goes and takes my feminism. We cannot afford to be this careless.
You shouldn't be so free with your feminism. I mean, you put it out in the open no matter who's around, and now look what happened.
You'll be fine.
I better be fine. I got a softball game.
Oh, please.
Hey, Mike. Oh, so glad spring is here, huh? Nice to get out of the office. Hey, you see the game last night?
Why does Sharon in accounting make less than Dan in accounting? I mean, don't they both do the same thing?
Because we can get away with paying women less.
Why?
Because, that's the way it is. Who cares?
Hey, I care. It just doesn't seem fair. I mean, if they both have the same job, they should both make the same salary.
It's gotten into you. I mean, it's been this way for the last 2 years. I mean, now you're upset?
Yeah. I am upset. Okay?
All right.
And being that we're on the topic, I wanted to talk to you about a maternity policy and building a new nursery in the building.
Is it Denise spread out what this is about?
This isn't about Denise. This is about equality and fairness.
Well, are you having a stroke? Because you seem like, I don't know what, you're not making much sense.
I feel empowered, you know?
Yeah?
Like I want to empower others. Okay. It's like this rush of a new experience. Yeah, I've never experienced
anything like this before. Yeah.
What do you want? Feminism. You feel it?
I feel
feel it right here?
Yeah, huh? I'm feeling it. I feel feministic.
Fairness.
Fairness,
equality.
Yeah. So you didn't see the game last night?
No.
Okay.
Clearly, this is a rich topic, and we have a full hour to figure it all out, or at least to start a rich and relevant conversation. We have an amazing panel of people. Just quick notes, we're on Twitter at Atlantic_live. You can use the hashtag WHCD. We're going to have time for your questions. Nobody be shy. We want everybody to participate. And with that, it is my great pleasure to introduce the Washington editor at large for The Atlantic, Steve Clemons, here to lead the conversation. And for the first time, a total delight to welcome Alex Wagner, senior editor for The Atlantic. This is going to be family-style seating. Take it away.
Great. Come on in, folks. We're going to bring you all in. Take your seats. What a great lineup we have here today. You know, I just want to say how impressed I am with how many of you didn't go to sleep last night to do a Saturday morning program after like White House Correspondents' Dinner craziness is incredible. Okay, we are all here. We're going to introduce our panel now. And first of all, we have, out of order, just wave. We're not going to be linear. So Jen Psaki, White House Communications Director, really cool wave out there. And I'm going to tell somebody, you know, I tell people to, you know, use your soccer voice for this kind of room. I'm going to ask all of you when you wave to wave real big, because when you're way back in the back, you look really small. So like, wait, Jen, do that again. Jen Psaki, there we go. Jay Newton, smallest Time Magazine Washington correspondent and the author of Broad Influence, How Women Are Changing the Way America Works. Jay Newton, small. And Lala Anthony, actress, entrepreneur, New York Times bestselling author, and now a Broadway producer. Over to Alex.
Can you guys hear me? Is
this yep.
Oh, you can? No, you can't.
There.
Can you hear me now?
Yes. Here you go. Come over here. Ooh, I can hear me.
Hello.
Donahue style? Okay. I got this one. I got the lock.
Okay, good.
All right. Can you hear me?
No.
Here, you want to talk into my mic?
This is so intimate. Okay. Welcome to the Dog and Pony Show. Stephanie Laing, where are you, Stephanie? Raise your hand. There you are. Stephanie Laing is a producer and director on the HBO comedy Veep, which I know you guys all love, and the creative mind behind the new female-driven comedy site Put Your Pretty On. We just watched one of their awesome videos.
Yay!
Senator Shelley Moore Capito is a Republican from West Virginia.
Yay!
Democrat Amy Klobuchar is the senior senator from Minnesota.
Great shoes.
Excellent footwear all around.
Yes.
And Hope Solo is a two-time Olympic gold medalist and the goalkeeper for the Women's World Cup winning team. I know you know Hope Solo. Take it away, Steve.
Okay, and then we have Connie Britton. Connie. Yeah. Connie Britton plays country singer Raina James in the ABC hit drama Nashville, and for five seasons was Tammy Taylor on Friday Night Lights. Very cool. And can I just compliment you on your footwear? I need work. Then we have Brad Smith, and I've got a present for Brad Smith. Brad is president of Microsoft, and I got you a feminism pill. There you go. And Maria Teresa Kumar, president and CEO of Voto, Latino, one of my pals at MSNBC. Thank you very much for being here. So.
Okay, do I have audio?
Yeah, you have an audio.
Oh,
turn it up.
Okay,
Alex, go
so
for it.
So this is going to be a raucous afternoon. It's not really afternoon, morning. Ladies, thank you for joining us. Chime in, everybody. Be funny, be original, be truthful. But I want to start, we're going to be talking about feminism in all its iterations across the economy and politics and business. But I want to start with feminism in the world of entertainment. And specifically, and I'll go to you first, Connie. Can you, are you on?
I don't know.
Is Connie on? No. Can some, I'll pass the mic to you. Can you use the F word in Hollywood? And I don't mean that F word. But I mean the feminism word. Can you walk into a room?
You saw the video that I did. I my hair. I guess nobody.
Can you be a self-avowed feminist in Hollywood today?
You know, there, it is still the F word in Hollywood, I have to say. And my experience with it is I have done it. I've kind of gone in the back door, which I highly recommend for those budding feminists out there. You know, I started out in a world in Hollywood where there were a lot of wife characters and a lot of, you know, best friend characters, and they were pretty one-dimensional. And when you start out, those are the ones you have to play. And I wanted to make them interesting, and I wanted to give them some gravity and some depth and some complexity and make them real women. And so I've been really fortunate to be able to do that, and Friday Night Lights was a really great opportunity for that.
Yes.
Because, of course, that was a world of football, and it was a very much a man's world, and the commitment that I made there was, we're going to give these women a voice, because these women are part of this community, and they are part of a world that is known to be male-dominated. And that's really the inspiration, because that's our culture today. It still is. We've made so many leaps and bounds, but we still are living in a culture that is descended from a very patrician society. And we have the power in many different ways, but one way that I suggest is the subtle backdoor route to show your voice, to show your complexity, to be sexy and graceful and a woman in all the depths of that, and to know your power and to take it and to reflect it to the world.
Let me ask Stephanie to jump on that, and I just want to take a moment. Where's Elizabeth Thorpe? Elizabeth, stand up, say wave it. This is the DC gladiator for PYPO. And she's here, and I just want to commend her for the DC Bureau Chief. But Steph, we do what we need to do, and I'm going to share my little mic with Stephanie. So Stephanie, you know, jump on Alex's.
This is perfect.
You can
hi.
Hold it.
Oh, good.
To.
I'm going to hold it. Hi. I completely agree with what Connie's saying. It's so important to. Oh, good. Oh.
There you go.
It's so so important to. I mean, feminism still is somewhat of an F word. We like to say it a lot at PYPO. It's why I started it. It was just something actionable for women, right? And if you don't start at the top, you can't make change. And then the writers, like we work with writers right now who come up with great ideas and then say, well, what if that lead is a woman? Why does it have to be the wife all the time? Or why does it have to be a cliche role? And thankfully, I think we're making some progress. I definitely noticed, I've been producing comedy for 20 years, but it wasn't until I started directing that I noticed a big difference. I felt like as a producer, I've done it for so long, I didn't think anyone could really question me. And I also think women tend to take those roles of mom role and sort of babysitting. But when you start directing, I was surprised at how many men wanted that or questioned that I should be doing that. So, yeah.
It seems like one of the sort of imperatives in this is to have women in leadership roles. Not just directing, but, you know, making big decisions at studios, wherever. I would say the same seems to be true for politics, that when you have female leadership, it's important in sort of engendering an interest in politics among young women, and also showing the country that, hey, guess what? Women can lead and do this. And I guess I want to turn to our two senators here, and I'll start with you, Senator Klobuchar. In terms of female representation in Congress, you know, women are half the country, but they're only, I think, 20% of our elected representatives. Does it matter to have women in Congress?
Yes. Yes, it does. And Shelley knows this. We've done a number of bills together, including one that we're actually, I think, going to pass on eating disorder, something that's been neglected forever, mostly because it kills women and not as many men. And so I think it makes a big difference down the line. We now have 20 women in the Senate, so they can no longer call us Sweet 16. And many of us are the first women elected in our states. And I remember when I was first running, I would go around repeatedly. This is 2006. I would be asked by reporters, editors of papers, well, can a woman win? Really? You think a woman can win? And I finally got to the point where I said, you know what? You know, I'm proud of being a woman. I'm proud of women's support. But I'm running as my background as a prosecutor. I'm running with what I've done. I'm running with my business leadership. I go through the whole thing. And every time I would do it, I would then end by saying, and you know what? That's the right thing to do, because last time I checked, half the voters were men. And if I was just running as a woman, I wouldn't win. And it actually made no sense at all. But all the men in the room would go, yeah, yeah. And I think what that was getting at was just kind of their fear that they were just going to put someone in that was just running as a woman. And maybe kind of the fear that one particular candidate is tapping into right now in the presidential race. So for me, what I look at when I see Shelley is we have such a great group of 20 women. We do things together constantly. We have dinners together. Of course, we never talk about the male senators. And we are a force to be reckoned with. When we all stood up for the Stronger Violence Against Women Act, the House had a weaker version. When all 20 women, Democrats and Republicans, stood up, guess what happened? We passed the bill because no one could fall to us. When Susan Collins, the Republican from Maine, stood up in the chamber after we'd had a shutdown for days and said, I'm asking people to join me. We have to have a group. I was the first Democrat to call her. She and I led this group of 14 half women, seven women in it. We let McCain in, but seven women. And we literally came up with a proposal, went to the leadership and said, we have 14 of us. If you don't do something like this in 3 hours, we have the press room reserved and we're gonna go forward with it. In 2 hours, they adopted a proposal like that. Time and time again, a Harvard study just actually put the numbers to it, that the women in the Senate got more done, passed more bills together, were on each other's bills. So does it make a difference? It's the only thing that will make a difference.
Senator Capito, as you answer Alex's question, I was just reflecting that you and Jennifer Garner must be the two most famous women of all time in West Virginia, because your victories in West Virginia were staggeringly large, the largest margins ever. And, you know, I'm interested in the critique that women like all of you are one-offs, anomalies, that you know, you've succeeded, but others can't necessarily follow. So I want you to reflect not only Alex's question, but is there a pathway? Do you mentor people? Are there others aspiring? Talk about the pipeline of great women leaders in your state and around the country.
Well, that's a good question without a microphone, I think, yes.
Yeah.
All right, good? Thank you. And it's a pleasure for me to join Amy in the Senate. I was in the House for 14 years before, where our numbers steadily increased. And she mentioned that there's 20 in the Senate right now, which is the all-time high. But for all of y'all in the audience to realize, over the course of the history of our country, we've only had 46 women. And so I decided—
Out of 1,917 senators.
Yeah.
But who's counting?
And I'm glad she quoted the study from Harvard that talked about how we're on each other's bills, how we support each other, how we talk through different amendments to, and we get more things passed. That's just the way, I think we're doers, task doers, we're multitaskers. We talk about that quite a lot because we're managing a lot of things in our lives at the same time. But one thing for me, when you talk about the pipeline, this is really important to me. I live in a small state, West Virginia. Jennifer Garner is from, her parents live like a half a mile from Charlie and I. So we know everybody knows each other, and no jokes about West Virginia. Everybody knows each other in West Virginia. And so, you know, I decided that what kind of legacy do I wanna have follow me as the first woman senator, much like Amy is. So we started, with the help of my great staff, something called West Virginia Girls on the Rise. And I decided fifth grade is the best place to catch them right before they get to middle school, having had a daughter and sons. I'm pretty good at this. But they're old enough to realize what I'm saying, and maybe something will click. And so we go into the schools, we just take the girls, and we talk about people who've been before us. It's very bipartisan. We don't get into any of those kinds of things. And talk about how do you develop the confidence, the education, and the physical well-being to be able to do. It's built on three stools. And it's so far, we've had a lot of success. The girls really enjoy it. We have a takeaway when we finish. And then I've been following up with the fifth graders because my father was in politics for a long time. And I get comments all the day about how he changed that young person's life to want to be in public service. I want my daughter to have some girl walk up to her 24 years later and say, I saw your mother and I wanted to do that. So we got to get more people in the pipeline, more mayors, more county commissioners, more school board members. That's how you get the pipeline. Amy was a prosecutor. I was in the House of Delegates. It's not like, unless you're really, really lucky and circumstances are unbelievable, that you just walk in, run for the Senate and win. It just doesn't happen too often like that.
Right.
But thank you.
Unless you're a man.
I was going
to... Jay?
I was going to jump in on that and say, so I wrote my book about, my book came about to begin with.
Tell them the name of the book again.
Broad Influence, How Women Are Changing the Way America Works. And it grew out of a story I wrote for Time Magazine about the 20 women of the Senate, including Senator Klobuchar, who came together during the government shutdown to restart the negotiations when none of the men would talk to each other. But it was fascinating to me to see in the Senate that particular session, by the way, the women actually produced 75% of the legislation that passed that Senate, which is just an amazing figure. And the height of dysfunction, they were the only ones talking to each other, only ones getting things done. But if you go back historically and you look at, like, back before 1992, which was the first time the women began to sustain a plural presence in the Senate, the funding for breast cancer research was $100,000 a year. Right? Isn't that amazing? Like, there was no Violence Against Women's Act. There was no SCHIP, which is the state children's health care insurance fund. There was no family paid medical leave. There was no paternity and maternity leave. Right? So all research that the National Health Institutes did was only on men. There was no research on women, even though our bodies are fundamentally different and react differently to all kinds of different things, right? So, like, and so the amazing amounts of legislation that women have gotten through in the last 30 years and continue to get through, and the changes they're making and the voices that they're bringing are so important.
Well, let me ask, jump to Lala for a moment, and any of you. One of the interesting things about the phase we seem to be in is that feminism is now breaking up into lots of different pools. And you've got, where's my friend Anna? Anna? I know many of you are millennials, but Anna Barber is out there anyway. So we have millennials in the room, and they just don't think Amy Klobuchar. Like, there's some big differences here. So substantial. I mean, maybe not that big. But, you know, this is always a dangerous conversation for people like Brad Smith
You're
and
brave,
myself.
Steve.
Right?
You're
so we're just going to sing. But my point is, can you talk a little bit about how the game is changing, breaking up, and how you see it from your perspective?
Sure. Okay, I do want to talk about that, but I want to talk about something else first, if that's
it. You get more chances at bat.
So I definitely want to say it's amazing to hear how, you know, women are taking over and we just rock and do so many amazing things. But for me, the most important thing is finally seeing women that look like me in these kind of positions. African-American and Hispanic women really becoming the power players in all of the industries that we talked about. And that's what drove me to want to be a part of the Broadway play Eclipse, starring Lupita Nyong'o, who we just found out were up for 3 Tony Awards. So I'm really excited about that. And you know, what drew me to that, I'm sorry, I'm so off your question, but I promise.
But as long as you talk about 10,000 girls.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna talk about that. So what drew me to the project was that it was, you know, the only project on Broadway that was all female, written and directed by females, all black, led by Broadway's only 2 black producers. And we started an initiative called the 10,000 Girls Initiative, which is near and dear to my heart, where we're giving 10,000 girls the opportunity to see Eclipse, to go to Broadway. And I know for myself, you know, growing up how I did, I never even heard about Broadway. I didn't even know it existed. It's something that never came up in my house because we never could dream to have access to something like that. So to be able to be in a position to now bring 10,000 girls to be able to see Broadway and this be their first experience on Broadway with Eclipse and it be such a powerful piece is something that I'm very, very proud of. So it's an initiative that I'm super strong behind and very proud of what we're doing.
Great.
Can I, on the question of women of color and how engaged they are or how engaged they are, you know, the feminist movement, the choices the feminist movement has made to involve women of color in prominent positions. I want to ask you, Maria Teresa, I mean, when you think of prominent feminists, especially from the era of Gloria Steinem, and even through to today, a lot of them are white. And yet a lot of the issues that feminism proposes to want to solve, including pay equity, paid time off, etc., disproportionately affect women of color. And I guess I wonder, from your perspective, is feminism, capital F, as inclusive as it needs to be when it concerns women of color?
I think what we're seeing right now, first of all, this is fantastic. My colleague brought her husband, and her husband said, are you bringing me to a subversive feminist rally this morning? Yes, you are, Joey, welcome. But in all seriousness, I have to say that I was looking up here and I saw Sonia Sotomayor, and it was the first name that popped out of there, and it was because growing up, you saw I cannot remember ever seeing a Latina woman of power in power until I was in college. And that was Denise Cheney, an assemblywoman out of California, who I interned for. And I think what we're seeing right now when we're talking about the feminist movement is how do we actually open up the conversation to ensure that you are presenting young voices that are increasingly have different perspectives from their mothers, but because the policies are impacting them disproportionately, they're actually waking up and saying, wait a second, I am a feminist. And I use this as an example. I'm on the board of Planned Parenthood. When I started on the board of Planned Parenthood 6 years ago, we were having a frank conversation of how are we going to bring young women into the fold because they just did not identify themselves as feminist. And then a wave of anti-choice legislation swept the country, and that kind of solved it for us. Only half joking. And it's because when you start looking at this idea of choice, the majority of women of color are under the age of 36. So they are in the process of family planning. They're in the process of trying to identify, are they going to have a career? Are they going to have a family? Are they going to continue their education? The average Latina, for example, is a 26-year-old woman. They don't want anybody interfering with those life decisions. And I think that it's incumbent on leadership in the feminist movement to ensure that we're creating pipelines for women of color to start actually being at the table. And what I mean by that is that it's incredibly difficult for folks to say, I am going to proactively try to bring you into a conversation if I don't know where you come from. And that is the case right now, I think, not just in the feminist movement, but it's definitely the case in politics. The average senator in the US, in the US Senate is a 72-year-old white male.
Yeah, we're like
feeling better already.
You are the millennial.
You guys are looking fine.
You got a deal.
I say this because. So I say this because if the average senator is a 72-year-old white male, when he goes home for Christmas, his grandchild is a college student at best. That means that his grandchild is not even interacting with the new demographics of America who are majority non-white in many states. So how can you have policies that are reflective of the country if you actually are not interacting with this new generation of Americans?
I just want to touch on that because I do agree with that completely. And the young women I talk to, they are very confused about feminism and what exactly it means. Like, they don't really get it. Is it a cult? Does it mean, like, they don't really understand what that means. And I feel like for the younger generation, and me being 35, I kind of fit in the younger generation.
You're a millennial.
I think what we have to do is speak their language, and a lot of times people miss that. And in speaking their language, that's social media, that's Instagram, that's Snapchat, it's Facebook,
right?
Those are the things that we're on all day long, and we're getting our messages through those channels. So it's very important that we speak their language for them to understand exactly what we're talking about when we talk about having a seat at the table and the feminist movement.
I'm just going to jump in here too. I'm not a millennial. I'm 37. I don't know if that makes us like post-millennial or if there's something. We can give ourselves a new label. But when I was in my 20s, like many people in their 20s, I thought that sexism didn't exist, that feminism was something that you sort of, you know, you burned your bra and did weird stuff, and that wasn't a real thing. And it really requires having some, you know, are you effing kidding me? I don't know if I can say that, but I didn't say the word. Moments where you realize this exists. And it's alive and well in Washington. It's alive and well, obviously, in Hollywood. And it's something that it's very important for us to talk about. And not just in the sense that it exists, but to tell your stories of your experiences with it. And I
a year ago, I went back to the White House a year ago, and I was 6 months pregnant, so it wasn't a secret that I was having a baby. It was very obvious. And when I was about 8 months pregnant, I was in a meeting in Josh Earnest's office, who's the White House press secretary, and we're sitting there and we're meeting this with this network correspondent who will go unnamed, and we're sitting there and this person is only looking at Josh in the entire meeting, and I'm thinking, well, that's weird. And Josh is saying, well, Jen can actually help you with that, and Jen may have some ideas, and she's actually the one who really deals with that, So anyway, you fast forward, you get to the end of the meeting, and I said to this person, you know, I hope you can call me anytime, happy to talk to you about any issues you want to talk about before you're going to go on air. And this person said, well, I'm not sure if I'll ever see you again. So, you know, thank you, but, and I had this moment where I thought, are you effing kidding me? You know. So I tell that story, and I tell that
Did
story.
Did that enemies list come back?
No, it's important to embrace people who are uninformed. But I tell that story to younger women because I think it's important for people to know in their 20s who often think, and I did too, well, it's exactly the same. And you know why that is? Because you're doing the same jobs and you're experiencing the same thing. But as people start to rise in their businesses, whether it's in Hollywood or in government, you do start to experience different reactions to you, different approaches in meetings, or people respond to you differently in meetings. And our work is not done. We have a lot more work to be done, but it's about the policies, but it's also a lot about the perceptions. And I think that's a piece that doesn't get enough attention and discussion.
This is great. I want to be sure to, you know, hit Hope Solo and some others, but to come back, I want to give Senator Klobuchar an opportunity on the, you know, on the issue of generational shifts and how, because I read The Senator Next Door, it's a really powerful kind of story about how you interact with people. And oftentimes, when you're in a position of leadership, you're listening to other people and trying to understand how they see you, how they hear you, how they do what they're doing. And so I'm just interested, you know, both among your male colleagues in institutions which you've worked, but also just different generations of people, what are the things that come and stand out to you as the parts of the shifting terrain, particularly because when we were trying to do this and define this, I want to be honest with everyone, it was very hard. I mean, look at Emily Lenzner here, our communications director, our team, Rob Hendon. We struggled over the title of this for a long time. It's just becoming a much more, it's not the same predictable, shouldn't say predictable, that'd be a bad word, the same feminism of 5 years ago. There's something new and different. I'm just wondering what you both have seen and as we move on the panel.
Yeah, well, I think first of all, I can relate to what Jen says. I think when women hit the workplace, they often have some experience that makes them understand, well, they may not have read every woman's history book about what Gloria Steinem did this for them and what, they have some experience that makes them think this just isn't fair. Or they start looking at the fact that most of their bosses are men, and that's still true. A Fortune 500 companies, very small percentage of there are women CEOs, tech, which will have about soon, issues with trying to integrate technology companies are huge, sports as we know, right. And problems there. So I think that's when it really hits. On the other hand, what I've seen with millennials and my daughter, who is one herself, always reminds me, Mom, the only reason that people say we're sleeping in the basement is because you guys screwed up. And we don't have, there's not enough jobs for us. That's why we're sleeping in our parents' basement. And so the point of it is they have come through a really hard time, most of them, this great downturn. They were the ones most hit. There weren't jobs when they came out. And now they're trying to catch up. And for them, what I've seen is this incredible idealism in terms of causes, whether it is gay marriage, whether it's climate change, and that's how they operate. And I was talking to an employer that was trying to recruit millennials, and he talked about making his company a cause for them, right? So I think that is going to go over into politics, especially this summer, when you see the presidential race is taking these causes to recruit young people, wherever they are in the political spectrum, to get interested. I just think it's a different way to look at getting people involved. And it's not just about, oh, you're the first woman. Oh, you're the first Hispanic. I think it's going to be a lot about the causes. Immigration, huge cause for them to get things done.
Thanks. Senator, quick.
I was going to tell a little anecdote of one of my first days in the United States Senate, and it was a going away dinner for the existing senators. Tom Coburn was one of those, and it's a tradition in the Senate to have a nice dinner for your colleagues who are leaving. And my husband was with me, and an unnamed senator walked in, and he looks at both of us. We're both seated, and he sits down next to Charlie, and he looks at Charlie, and then he looks at me, and then he looks back at Charlie, and he goes, "So how do you like life in the Senate?" And my husband goes, "It's her." Oh, I knew that. I knew that. I meant as a family. How do you like? And someday I'll tell you who it is, and it won't surprise you. In any event, but the purpose in that telling that story is, all of us are in competitive worlds. You know, you're in the competitive world of broadcasting, marketing and high tech, politics, athletics. Certainly, entertainment's got to be one of the most highly competitive. I think what we've all learned is you get knocked down, you just got to pick yourself back up and keep on going. And sometimes I think we have trouble with that. We get knocked down that first time and we think, "Oh, I'm not going to do that anymore." You know, elections, most of the people that we serve with have lost. I haven't, but have lost. And Amy hasn't, so. Have lost at least one time in something. Oh, I did lose. That's right. My senior year in high school, I did not get it. I forgot about that.
Senator,
but in any event,
Who's keeping track of the losses? Yeah. Right?
In any event, I think that those are important lessons that we've learned. And then the younger generation is just better at that. They've played more competitive sports than we have. They've had more losses, you know, to try to pick themselves up. And so I'm very much in admiration as the mother of a 30-year-old daughter and some sons as well who are very competitive. They just got to keep on going. That's the lesson we've tried to teach them.
Speaking of getting knocked down and picking yourself back up, Hope Solo, you know something about contact sports. And, you know, I think part of feminism is not only talking the talk but walking the walk, right? I mean, part of it involves battles and fighting for what you think is right, and you are at the front lines of the battle for pay equity as it concerns women in sports and specifically women in soccer. And, you know, I wonder from a professional standpoint, how hard has it been to lead that fight, right? I mean, I'm sure there are plenty of people who are like, "What are you doing?"
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. It's been, is it fun?
Yeah.
I've been on the team now.
No?
We're giving you 2 or 3.
How about now?
Yeah.
So I've been on the team now for 17 years, and every year has been a fight. I've been on the team through 4 different cycles of CBA negotiations, and you see a little bit of improvement, but you don't make major gains. In no way can you consider it equal in comparison to the men. And so we're at, you know, 17 years later, and you're trying to lead this group filled with women who are scared to stand up to our employer, who have been intimidated year in and year out, where if we take a stance, we might lose our health insurance. We might not make a roster. We might not get our game scheduled. We're going to lose money if we stand up and if we fight for what's right. So oftentimes we talk about taking a stance, but then we get too scared to have all 20, 30 women in the same room to do it together. And finally, this last year, we decided, you know what, enough is enough. We are the best in the world. We are successful. But it's been a long road. This didn't happen overnight. But we bring in more revenue than our men's team. This last year, we brought in $20 million in revenue for the Federation, for the United States Soccer Federation. The men's team had a net loss of $2 million.
Wow.
So when you look at the numbers alone and the facts, well, then we can, we win. We're the best in the world. We're the best in the world. But when you look at the numbers, it's pretty easy. I mean, we want fair pay for equal, you know, equal pay for equal play. We put in the same amount of work. We do the same job. We make more money. We have higher viewership. And yet, we're getting paid 25 cents to the dollar. So, I mean, we have a long road, but I'm very proud of my team. We actually filed a complaint with the EEOC, with the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission.
Thank you. You know, one of the things that Alex and I have been talking about in this, in terms of what we call this, the unfinished or really the never-ending revolution. And frankly, it would make me really happy someday never to have a topic on feminism or LGBT rights or civil justice or over. I mean, just let's solve it, right? And so one of the our friends, good friend of mine, Brad Smith, who is happens to be a guy, but that's not why you're up there. But you're president of Microsoft. And part of your portfolio is diversity, inclusion, dealing with these issues. And I can't think, as I think around the sort of Fortune 100 companies, of any other president of a major firm that has your portfolio. And I'd love to hear how you think about moving the needle on these issues of gender. And what can we do so that organizations like ours don't have to keep highlighting this? Like, just put it out of business by solving it.
Well, first of all, I think anybody who comes from the tech sector has to start with, frankly, a deep sense of humility.
Right.
Because the road ahead of us is far longer than the road that we've come so far. We have so much progress, as Senator Klobuchar said, that we still need to make. I do think it starts with making the case. To me, the case is that diversity, feminism, is good for people and good for business. I believe that every company should strive to become as diverse as the customers it serves. It will understand its customers. It will do a better job of meeting their needs. And I think if we're going to move the needle, it really requires that we think in a very thoughtful and systemic way, basically about four things. First, how do we get women into the workforce so that they represent their representation in the population? Second, how do we ensure that women are valued, which I do believe means equal pay for equal work.
Yeah.
And this is the one area where the tech sector actually is better than most, at least. I mean, at Microsoft, it's 99.8 cents to the dollar for women doing the same job as a man. Apple's 99.6, Amazon 99.7, so we're close. Then there's a third area where we're far away, I think, which is really an equal opportunity to do equal work. And that means everything from having the right benefits in place to serve women and other groups. But fundamentally what it means is equal opportunities to advance. You ultimately want to see women rising up. You want to see promotion rates that are the same. And then the last goal, I think, is ultimately important to keep in mind as well. And that is to build a workplace that is not only diverse but inclusive. So people are listening to each other, learning from each other, building on each other. That's how you really capture the power of this diversity. And I think if we have clear goals, clear measurement, because if you are not measuring this every year, you will have great statements but little progress, and ultimately clear accountability. When you make managers accountable, and these days, as you heard, more managers are men than women, and you make their bonuses turn on advances in diversity, and you do this year after year after year, then you start to see progress. And someday, we will reach the point where this revolution is finished, but we're not anywhere near there today.
When you talk about responsibility, we often frame feminism in terms of the responsibility that men in particular have to women. And there's that sort of gender divide, but I'd ask you, Connie, what is the responsibility that women have to other women? And I know on Nashville, you play a star whose success is in danger of being eclipsed by the success of a younger woman. And I guess I wonder the sort of inter-female dynamic. What do you think the responsibility is on the part of older women as it concerns younger women on the subject of feminism?
Well, I've been sitting here listening to...
We'll switch.
Okay. As I've been listening to all this, I can't help but feel that we are really poised for a cultural shift, because I'm looking out and there are all these millennials out here, and you guys are the ones listening to the conversation. And, you know, as I think about the conversation of women in the Senate, women in the workplace, women being paid equally, I realize that the only way that that's going to happen is if we get the culture in line with the idea of equality and gender equality. And we are in a position where we can do that. And all of us here, you know, my role here today is simply because as a person who has been able to represent women who are empowered. And I do that. I try to do that for the culture. I try to do that so that I can be a role model in some way. But we can all do that. And I think we all have a responsibility to each other as women to lift each other up. But I think we also have a responsibility to reach out to our men, because the men have to be on board. It's the only way we're going to make a change. And you know, the thing is, there's no reason why they shouldn't be on board, and particularly millennial men. I mean, the millennial men that I know are really rad. Like, they're super cool. And, you know, so let's get them going on this. Let's de-stigmatize the idea of feminism. Let's de-stigmatize the threat of what it means to be paid equally and treated equally. Let's get rid of the idea that somehow, if we're being treated equally, we've lost our femininity. That has nothing to do with it. So I really right. think that we all have, and all of us up here and everybody in the audience, has an opportunity to represent what it is to be an empowered woman and an empowered man. And let's take that out into the world and change the culture. It's the only way it's gonna happen.
I think this is such an important point, and it flows over into government and politics as well, in that not all men are bad mentors or are anti-feminist, and not all women are feminists and feminists, I guess I should say. And I think many of us have probably had experiences where women have beaten us down and not rooted for us. And that's sad. And the only way we change it is by not being that woman ourself, our woman ourself. I'm not sure if that's grammatically correct. So ourselves, sorry, don't tell anyone about that. So that I think is hugely important. I have had probably more male mentors than female mentors. Huh. That is not just because there are more men in high positions in government. That is sometimes because women see you as competition, or women don't want to help you because they see you getting a little too close to their heels or wedges or shoes or whatever they may be. That is a travesty and something that I think we need to change. I hope I'm helping to change, but one of the ways, and the last thing I'll say, is that when I meet with people on my team or younger women in their 20s, I'm not that old, but I'm not a millennial. Just say it again. But oftentimes when I talk to them now, we have 8 months left in the administration, and people want to talk about what am I going to do next and what am I qualified for. And I always say, you work in the White House. You're going to be just fine, I think. But a lot of women will say to me, well, I'm interested in that, but I really have no experience, and so I don't think I could do that. Or, you know, I don't really know anything about technology, so probably I should just, you know, go to a PR firm, which is great too. But, I say to them, you know who doesn't say that to me when they come in here? Millennial men who say, I don't know anything about technology, but I think I'm gonna go be the CEO of a technology company, right? So I think we need to change that also, as women are coming up in government and many, many industries, about how you can learn and you can own a new field, and you don't have to come to it with the level of qualifications or knowledge you think you need.
Let me ask you, I want to recognize Gabrielle Carteris. Gabrielle, if you'd stand for a minute. Gabrielle, many of you will know from 90210, lots of things. She's the president of SAG-AFTRA. It's a great pleasure to have you with us. Give Gabrielle a mic. But I want to ask Stephanie and Gabrielle just very quickly. We're in lightning round here, so shorter form. You know, we're gonna, you know, or Alex Wagner's gonna cut. But the thing I'm interested in is Connie just said she feels as if we're at a cultural shift point, an inflection point. And oftentimes, if that's true, and gravity just takes us to a better place, and none of us have to really do anything, that's one story. Or is it you have to go claim this, that it's a campaign, that yes. gravity is not taking us there? So I'd love to get your perspective, at least on the Hollywood front, and get, you know, Maria Trace and others to sort of comment. Can we just kind of kick back, or is there have to be an action plan?
I just want to say one thing. In no way, sorry to interrupt you. In no way was I saying we were going to have to kick back.
Do I misinterpret?
I did not take it as a kickback.
Thank you. Not
awesome.
At all.
But very good.
I have a national story that I want to tell.
Yes, great. Thank. So yeah.
I absolutely believe we have to fight, stand up, show everybody who we are. We're able to do it. I do it with my girls. We have to do it as a community of women, take care of each other. And yes, we have to invite the men who are there to stand with us.
Absolutely.
And,
I
was just going to say, so too often you see like companies, especially in the private sector, say, you know, they, well, we have a gender program, but it's totally just PR, right? It's like, oh, we're just, you know, this is like the smoothing over, here's our gender, women's, you know, women, you all should all get together and like hang out and like do something together. And like, but there's actually a business case for this, right? There's a very sound business case. So when you have 30% women on any corporate boards, there's a ton of research out there that shows this, what companies are 26% more efficient. They are 45% more profitable. That's crazy. Why wouldn't you want that, right? They have to restate their earnings 55% less. So there's a major business case for this to happen. It's just that companies aren't doing it, and it's not going to happen naturally. It has to be something where you get people to do it, you force people to do it, you raise the stakes.
Right.
I think
right.
Also, I don't think it's just forcing, though. I think it's inviting. I think we have to be inviting the people to join together. I don't think, even though when I say it's like leaning in, leaning forward, it is about us, it's about inviting people to join us, that we can do it together, that there's no reason we have to be separate. We are all building the same vision together.
Right,
we
thank
actually
you.
Want the best.
Thank you.
I also think it's fighting for what you're worth. Because oftentimes, I can tell you when I'm interviewing a candidate, the male candidate will always negotiate the salary. Very rarely will the female negotiate the salary, and sometimes we actually have to nudge them. That said, one of the reasons that millennial women are, we really need to start focusing on making sure that their livelihood is fair, is that they walk out the door with the exact same student debt, because that student loan does not know gender.
Right.
But when you walk in and you're not negotiating your salaries and you're not seeing it, all of a sudden young women are actually at a deficit already compared to their male counterparts.
Amy, did you want to?
Well, yeah, it was just this idea that I've seen so many times with young people thinking of running. You know, a woman says, literally said to me, well, I don't think I can run for Congress. I don't know the big issue with trade. I don't know anything about it. And a man thinks he knows enough because he drives a Volvo. Okay? So that is a true story. But what I did want to get to, I know this is like icky electoral politics and everyone's doing kumbaya here, we're not talking about it, but I do have to raise a point that if you're looking for a moment, there is going to be a major national discussion about gender when Donald Trump is staying on the national stage, that Hillary Clinton's playing the woman card. There was a cartoon this week that showed a police officer stopping a woman, and he said, ma'am, I need your driver's license, I need your proof of insurance, and I need your woman's card. So the point is, this is not just going to be a joke, though. This is a serious thing. Dana Milbank wrote a column today in the Washington Post, so you should read. He talked about, this isn't the woman's card, this is the man's card he's playing. And in my perspective, it's at the bottom of the deck. And so we are going to be having a major discussion about gender and whether or not someone can be qualified outside of being a woman. I think you know my answer to that. And in the end, the women of this country are going to have to decide if they're going to play their woman's card, and that's going to be the card they vote on.
Connie, you had a story you wanted to share.
I was going to share a story, getting back to your question, actually, from Nashville, because in terms of the way women treat each other and how we can empower each other, I shot the pilot of Nashville, which I thought was about, you know, the change in music, the music industry, the change in the way we approach it, how modern media has affected music and everything, you know, all arts and entertainment. And then suddenly, after the pilot was aired, people started writing about it, about how it was, you know, a younger artist versus an older artist. And I was like, what? That's not, I didn't do that show. That's not the show that I signed on to do. But immediately, the media and even the people behind the show who were trying to publicize it were sort of couching it in that way. And I have fought every day and continue to, and sometimes don't feel very successful, to say, this is not what this show is. This is not one woman against another woman. This is not a cat fight. It is about all of us trying to be out there and all the different influences that we have in the world and in the media and how we are managing that. But, you know, my feeling is the opportunity that we have on our show, but also that we all have and you guys have on Veep as well, is to tell these stories and change the way that we envision it. And that is a very subtle thing, and it's an uphill road for sure, but we have to fight for that.
Stephanie?
Yeah, so I would say I completely agree, again. It really is astonishing to me how, okay, I didn't have a lot of female mentors. I had male mentors, and it's the same thing you were saying. It's like, it's not because there were lack, they just, those were the ones that helped me. I was so surprised at this competition that existed that I never created and wasn't actually participating in. And so I think it is on us. We have to stand up. We have to be fearless, and we do have to fight and absolutely change the storyline. It's on us. We're writing the storylines. We have to cast with diversity. I mean, if we're not asking the questions, we're not inviting men to the conversation, we're failing.
Yeah. Can I just add on to what Amy was saying? Yeah. I think the biggest challenge for women is executive office, right? So women are perceived to be win-win and consensus builders, and that helps them get elected to legislatures or to boards, but they actually have the biggest challenges with executive office. And you see that happening with Hillary Clinton right now, and she's running for office. And you have to be both likable and tough, which is very tough needle to thread, whereas men don't have to prove that they're tough. They don't have to prove that they're capable. And for her, you've seen it, like when she, you know, she gives speeches and Bernie can yell at you for 40 minutes and like, you know, and you're like, yeah, yell at me more. And she gives a speech and she raises her voice. Right. And everyone's like, oh my God, mom's screaming at me. Like, what's going on?
Right,
you know?
Right.
And like, or she like, you know, she can't dream the way that Bernie dreams in big ideas because she's a woman. She must be pragmatic. And she's be like, no, Bernie, we can't buy that jet ski. We have to save for college. You know? And so,
hey, Brad. Thank you, Brad. You, as you climbed the Microsoft ladder, I know you were general counsel, you were a lawyer, and I want to bring in a friend of mine. I don't know if we have a mic over here real quick, but for Kathleen Biden, who's a hero. You know, women lawyers, women attorneys are often in a situation where they're screwed by circumstances because the case law, the caseload that they've got to do, that they proceed with over their career, if they go off and have families and whatnot, when they come back, they're at a significant disadvantage. And Kathleen helps run a program called DC Volunteer Lawyers Program, which are basically pro bono attorneys who go and defend women in violence cases and others and do this. One of the, I think, unexpected benefits of it is a lot of the female attorneys who go and do this pro bono work on the side of their lives, it's enabled them to continue to kind of keep the caseload and not be at a structural, I find it outrageous that they're at a structural disadvantage. But I'm interested in your world of all of this. Yesterday, Devin Wenig, the CEO of eBay, said technology companies, that there's a bro culture. And I'm interested in how you undo the bro culture in a constructive way, solve things like what Kathleen is trying to do. The White House is having a June 14th women's summit called United State of Women. You go to it, unitedstateofwomen.org, that you're also doing. But how do you make it not just fluff and fig leaves that cover a lot of, you know, essentially bias?
You know, it's a great question.
You're on.
There's two things one needs to do. I think first, one does need to create more alternatives. So, you know, if people, in this case women, want to work part-time, they can. If they want to take time off but stay connected, they can. If they want to re-enter the workforce.
Without penalty.
They can. And so, you know, we're constantly striving to create more programmatic ways for them to do that. I do think at the end of the day, it always takes certain role models to break whatever ceiling is there. And that's where it does take real acts of courage, I think, and then learning from everybody else. I won't use a person's name, but I'll tell a story about somebody who's actually in the audience today. 20 years ago, 1996, I had to hire a person to lead our legal team based in Tokyo and be responsible for Japan, Korea, and China. I concluded that the best person for the job was someone I had previously worked with who was a woman. Now, this also captures the degree to which feminism really is a global issue. It's not just a national issue. After I made that decision, one of our senior most executives stopped by my office and said, look, I'm all for women in the work, but Japan? You think you can put a senior woman in Japan? And I said, trust me, she will be the best person for the job. 2 years later, in 1998, we were negotiating an antitrust agreement with the Japanese Fair Trade Commission. She was there, and she was 8 months pregnant. It was the first time in the history of Japan that senior government officials ever negotiated with a woman who was 8 months pregnant. It was one of the fastest negotiations that ever happened. But I'll also remember this.
Yeah.
2 months after that successful conclusion, that same senior executive stopped in my office and he said, you know, I just want to say, I remember telling you that she wasn't the right person for the job. And I just want to say, you were right and I was wrong. She clearly is. And I've told that story many times in Microsoft, not only because what it says about the opportunities for women, but the opportunities for learning by men. I yeah. think they have to go together.
Never underestimate pregnant women.
I want to ask you all, you know, ambition and tenacity and also hope. I mean, these are things you need to cultivate with young women, and you're a role model for so many young women.
Like, thank you.
What do you talk to them about? I mean, how do you keep them hopeful and ambitious and tenacious about pursuing change and success?
Yeah, definitely, because I do want to speak to the young women out here, because that's what my cause is, and like you said, who I speak to the most. And you know, a lot of young women ask me, okay, well, what can I do? Like, I'm listening to all this stuff, it sounds good, but what can I do? And the first thing I would say you could do is, still, you have to be the best at whatever you do. He didn't give her the job because she was a woman. He gave her the job because she was the most qualified for the position. Mm. So you have to be the best at what you do. Be the most talented at what you do. And also, to speak, what we all talked about is supporting each other. I see it tremendously in the African American and Hispanic communities. We don't support each other. But us women, we talking about the next one. Oh, she thinks she cute. Look what she got on. She ain't all that. This, I mean, that's what we do. No one supports each other. Where it's cattiness. It's bringing each other down. We have to present a united front if we want to be taken seriously in the workplace and in any place. So it's about supporting each other, and it's still about being qualified and being the best at whatever it is you put your mind to and what you want to do.
Right, like Beyonce releases Lemonade, and we're not talking about Jay-Z's infidelity, we're talking about Becky with the good hair and who she is, right? Like, the problem here is the dude, not Becky with the good hair. Sorry, I just had to say that. I was like, we gotta weave Lemonade in here. Here's my question, and Jen, I'll ask you, you know, should it, I think that we're reaching, for a moment, you couldn't say the word liberal, right? And now you're allowed to say the word liberal again. And I
liberal.
Think the same was sort of true for feminism, right? There was a moment where it was sort of taboo. It's coming back into the vogue. But my question is, should we even be using that word? Because when we talked about civil rights, it wasn't blackism. It was like, this is civil rights. When we talked about marriage equality, the gay rights movement started framing it as a human rights issue. And I guess when you're talking about pay equity and gender equity, this is a civil rights issue. Is it too reductive to call it feminism?
I think the challenge with the term feminism is that it means a lot of different things and nothing to people. And so I think it's most important to talk about what
means
the issues are. Sorry, what'd you say?
The pill.
The pill. Okay. The pill, yeah. I couldn't see the video, so I don't even get the joke.
It was a really cool video, but yeah, they all know what I'm talking about.
But I think one of the it's important, I think, to talk about what the issues are under the bucket and make it real and tangible to people. And you know, one of the experiences I had, and as Brad was talking about this, I mentioned I came back to the White House when I was 6 months pregnant. And one of the experiences I had was realizing my own self-limitations I was putting on myself, because I was probably 4 months pregnant at the time. It's a Saturday afternoon. Dennis McDonough, the chief of staff at the White House, calls me and says, hey, listen, Jen Palmieri, who's now the communications director for Hillary Clinton, she's leaving. I just found out. We really need you to come back and do this job. And in that 15 seconds, I thought to myself, he must not know I'm pregnant. So I'll tell him, and then he'll say, oh, congratulations, good luck. It's all this happened in about 10 seconds in my head. Point being, I assumed that his reaction would be, oh, good luck with that, and we'll be in touch. His reaction, to his credit, was, that's great, we'll work it out, we'll figure it out. And I think one of the things we don't talk about are all the specifics. And I didn't think, it took me a while to really determine if this was a possibility, because I didn't know other women who were in a lot of senior government jobs who were pregnant. And it seemed like it was irresponsible or not possible, or I'm not sure what.
And so I think it's important to, I tell anybody who's in their 20s and 30s, go have babies, it's fine, people will figure it out, it will work out. But we need to talk about all these pieces that are specific individual experiences. Right. That's more important, I think, than saying feminism or equality. It's important, but what is it about?
I think one of the things, too, that we have to have a conversation around, too, is the policies that ensure that men can also play an active role in childcare. We are constantly placing it on the woman, but what is it, how do we actually make sure that they're in the conversation? And it does take a village. I mean, I am the mother of a 3-year-old and a 2-year-old, and it would only be possible with an amazing partner, but also an amazing team, that mm-hmm. we actually put something in place and saying, this is the vision, and this is how we're going to go forward. But we have to recognize that we keep giving the burden to the woman. It's like, no, it's actually something that's collective, number one. You didn't do it alone, or maybe, which is awesome too, but really it's like, but really, I think we oftentimes do not actually make the man and have those conversations in the workplace of how the man should also be able to take parental leave. And I think that Silicon Valley is actually leading the way in many cases.
I just want to put on the table and highlight for a moment that The Atlantic ran a cover story called Why Women Still Can't Have It All by Anne-Marie Slaughter, who's now done a book titled Unfinished Business, essentially looking at how relationships need to change, are changing in such a way that those are greater negotiation, more fluid than they traditionally were. Anne-Marie was invited, she's in California flying back today, and loved this program and wanted to be here to raise this. I want to go to the audience for just a moment. I want to ask Hope a question. I know you've had incredible public support for the lawsuit that you and your teammates have brought. I'm also interested in whether you've heard from women in other sports and whether or not what you've done becomes a template. We may be seeing this replicated in basketball, in hockey, and other areas where there are also outstanding teams and outstanding players who have been disadvantaged and biased against.
Well, we have had an outpouring of public support from senators, from congresswomen, from the current president, from possibly the soon-to-be president. We've had incredible public support. Now, you have to keep in mind, people ask all the time, well, what you guys are doing, is it going to trickle on down to the WNBA? You have to keep in mind that we have the same employer. The U.S. men's team and the U.S. women's team is employed by U.S. Soccer Federation. So the WNBA and the NBA, it's in completely two different entities.
I see.
So we can only hope that we're going to influence change across the board with all sports. But we do have the same employer, and that's why we are able to file our lawsuit.
Fascinating. Should we go to the audience? Alex, let's go here. I'm going to, if we don't mind, because I had mentioned Kathleen before, give you the chance for the first question, then we'll go right here. Go ahead.
Thank you. First, I think you should probably add to the title Smart Business, too, because I think what we're learning is it isn't just about fairness. It's about it's proven success. What we're doing in June with the White House, the United States of Women's Summit, is to celebrate all the work that's been done by women. And you know, some of the work at the White House has been doing with the Lilly Ledbetter Act and the Violence Against Women. So we can celebrate that, but also to say, which is my question to all of you, is there's still so much work to be done. And why are the younger women saying, not associating themselves as feminists? And so how do we talk to them in a way that says, actually, it's not okay. Like, open a boardroom anywhere and you're not in it. And so much work still needs to be done. And so what we want to do at this summit is make it an action-based summit so that when all of you leave here today and you're thinking about what we talked about, well, what do? What's the next step? Where do you join? What is your role in civic engagement in business? And so how do we bridge that?
Senator Capito, how would you answer that from the part of the world where you are?
Well, I think part of it is feeling your own power and knowing how to use your own power. This came home to me quite briskly when I was first elected, and I was having an argument with our middle son, a discussion, and he was frustrating me, as he really good at. And I said to him, finally, I was trying to kind of push him off a little bit, and I said, I'm a United States Congresswoman. I have a lot of power, and you have to do what I'm telling you to do, because I know what's right. And he turned and looked at me, and this stuck with me, because this has been a long time ago, and he said, Mom, You don't have power if you don't use it. And think about that in your own lives. I think about this every day because I have not figured out how to use my power in the United States Senate yet. I'm looking at role models like Amy and others and to try to help me develop how to use my own power. And so I think for younger, I think what happens, I mean, in my view, younger millennials, a lot of the battles that we're talking about at some of our levels are have already been fought in their minds. It's over. You know, I'll take the discussion on contraception, which my party was getting all hung up in last year or 2 years ago. And my daughter's calling me, and she goes, didn't that get decided in the 60s or 50s? And I'm like, yes, it did. You know, we got to get over this. So I think that, you know, these battles are, now I think she and folks of her age are trying to figure out, how do I have that baby and go walk in and get hired and soldier on? I mean, I just read Anne-Marie Slaughter's article again before I came over here today, and the pushes and pulls. It's about setting priorities, what's important, scheduling around your priorities, finding somebody to tell you, it's okay. You know, you missed the soccer game. I keep using my family, but I remember a second election, daughter's 16 by this time. I mean, we're in New York walking around. I said, I can't come to, and I named a whole list of things that I could not come to because I had to campaign. And she said, stop it right now. I am so proud of you. I am so inspired by what you do. I mean, but what it did, all this mother guilt and all this guilt that we all feel every now and then, we don't like to talk about it, but we have it, it just released me. Mm-hmm. So my own daughter, my own now millennial daughter, released me from all of those angst of feelings. Not to say I still don't have them. So, I mean, I think it's about support. It's knowing your power, right. Knowing how to use it.
The Capito children are a sassy bunch.
No. This idea of the husbands playing a bigger role, I mean, that's what Sheryl Sandberg's book was in part about, right? For me, I just had that same experience. My daughter said to me once, Mom, you're not a helicopter mom, like all my moms, my kids, the other kids in school. I know you're not, Mom. Right. What you are is a submarine mom. And I thought, that sounds so tough and cool. What is it? She goes, well, Mom, it's not really, but it means you lurk under the surface and come up all the time unexpectedly. And that's the same thing. I'm like, okay, I can handle being a submarine mom if that's what I am. Yeah. And I think it's not expecting yourself to meet every expectation from the past.
Right. Yes.
We have, go ahead.
No, tell who you are.
Okay, Elise Nelson, I'm president and CEO of Vital Voices. Yes, I'm 8 months pregnant, or actually I'm 9 months.
Yes!
Just so everybody heard, this is the president and CEO of Vital Voices, which just, we haven't talked much about the global scene, but I just want to tip my hat because you're worried and thinking about women all around the world.
Thank you. So just this week, a couple days ago, there was a great study that Harvard Business Review put out that basically said that women in positions of power, as compared to men in positions of power, the women are bolder leaders, meaning that basically they challenge the status quo more, they're better at leading people through crisis. But as we know, the problem is there just aren't that many women in power to exercise this boldness. One of the things that I find, certainly in this country, but also around the world, is that when you talk to women about power, and seizing power, they don't like that word. It's upsetting to me because we all know power is important to seize, but they don't like it. So how do you, as women who have power, redefine it? Because I think it's the responsibility of those who have power, who are women, to redefine it, to make women want to go after it.
In 10-second sound bites.
I can just say, hold on to your grace and know that your power is specific to being a woman. So don't let it doesn't need to be a threatening thing. It can be a graceful thing. And that's that which is very feminine. So hold on to your femininity, hold on to your grace, and then go for it.
I have this awesome quote that I recently ran into, but basically it's like, they took everything away from me, including my fear. And when you see it through that lens, it gives you incredible power because you're saying, if you have a vision that you're trying to achieve, what are they going to do to you? You're displacing it.
Guys, I would love this to go on for another hour. We can't. We can all hang out and talk, but the program's going to have to be brought to a close. But the way we're going to do this, Alex and I have not consulted. But we are going
Steve.
To be engaged, many of us and many of you, over this weekend with lots of people. There are a lot of, I used to walk up to Hollywood stars that would come into town and say, why are you here? And some of them would just stumble. They didn't really have a reason. They didn't have a cause. They didn't have a thing. Now they know that if they see me, they better have an idea that they're, some cause, education, women's rights, LGBT issues, whatever it may be, they're on the spot. I ask them, and I used to blog about it and do the Hall of Shame. But I want to say, as you go around and you reflect on today in just 10 seconds, What should we have talked about that we didn't, or what will you tell people when you see them out of the White House Correspondents' Dinner, the Vanity Fair party, whichever party is out there? What will you take from this, short form?
I would say that I'm loving this. It's like we're getting conversation going, and then I would take, let's do something actionable.
Well, you're doing it.
Yeah.
Maria Teresa.
I would actually say that when we start talking about minimum wage, when we start talking about pay equity, parental leave, millennial, Latino, women, we're actually talking about the same voter. And when we can figure that out, we can actually address the issues that are right now at the intersection of our countries.
I hate going linear, Mala.
I was totally inspired by this panel. I feel like I learned a lot. If there was one thing I wish we talked about more, was just emphasizing how to talk in a language that young people understand, and utilizing social media to put that language out there, because that's what our young lives are about right now.
Brad?
I'd build on that. I'd say the how. How we make progress, how we measure whether we make progress, how we reach new people and bring them in.
Senator Amy Klobuchar?
I learned that the best way to make that progress and talk about it in the right way is talk about Hope Solo.
Oh! Hope Solo.
There's so much
when
more.
When you're at that table tonight, what are you gonna tell?
Well, what I learned tonight is there's so much more to be discussed. But I think we all have to embrace our power, just like we talked about here. But it's about taking it. And I think so often men fear powerful women. And I think a lot of times that's why women are afraid to exert themselves. But we have to take our power, because nobody's going to hand it to us. And at the end of the day, if we settle for anything else, we're not helping our cause. So we cannot settle. We have to continue pushing forward.
Senator Shelley Moore Capito.
Well, I would build on that and just say it's about confidence. It's building confidence with those fifth graders that I'm talking with in my state, starting young so that they're inspired to go into tech fields or athletics or into acting or whatever, hopefully become senators. Building confidence early is going to pay dividends for us all in this room later.
Jen Psaki.
I think I'm okay.
If you're critiquing us, that's why we turned
no.
the
video. How powerful. It's like we're in Russia. I'm gonna work it in. So I just would build off of what Lala said. As we're all talking about the women, feminism, I think it's important to treat millennial women as educated, interested voters. It's not just
right.
about I'm a woman, you're a woman. Millennial women, all women care about climate change, health care, criminal justice, all these issues. People are on different sides of the aisle on it, or different sides of the issues, but we need to not just stop the conversation at being a woman in feminism. We need to talk about the substantive issues and present those issues to 20-somethings as the educated people that they are.
Jay Newton Small.
I would say that what we didn't talk about, and I wish we had a little bit more time to, is that we're on the cusp of a revolution. And so by the year 2030, the baby boomer generation will have fully retired from the workforce and will be short 26 million workers in America. There's only two ways to make up that shortfall. One, you bring in a ton of new immigration, which isn't very likely with this Congress. Or two, you bring women fully into the workforce. Just by bringing women fully into the workforce, you fill that hole almost completely. So we are almost there. By the year 2030, we could really see women approaching parity.
Connie Britton.
I got so much inspiration from what everybody here said today, and I feel that that's important for me and for everybody, because we can go out there and we can reflect it to the world. The one thing that I would love to have touched on is the international and the global aspect, as you
yes.
mentioned, because there is a workforce around the world of women who are being oppressed, who have no ability. Empowerment isn't even in the vocabulary. And that is a workforce where if we can reach out around the world, I can't even imagine the change that it would make in terms of wars, in terms of poverty, and numerous other aspects. So I just think that we need to pay attention, and I do think feminism is an important topic, but it is a human issue, and we need to remember it's a human issue for all of us.
That's great. Did I get everybody? I think I did. I want to say a word about Alex Wagner, who's been my partner in this. I want to ask Alex the same thing, but I think that as we've sort of talked about models of people who are performing, shaping ideas, engaging, our senior editor at The Atlantic, Alex Wagner, who on MSNBC has just sort of shown how to do it. But I'm interested in your tough critique of moving the needle from your, not as an interviewer, but I'm interviewing you. What would you think that is missing in putting this kind of topic out of business?
Men. I mean, look, props to all the gentlemen in here. I know one of them's my husband and one of them's your husband, but like people who are not our husbands and or their husbands, it's great to have you here. I wish there were more of you. A round of applause. You know, I think my issue with the word feminism is it begins with F-E-M, and it is really, I mean, it is this basic civil right. And if you said, oh, all Asian people make 75 cents on the dollar, it'd be immediately, well, that's not okay. But when you say it's women, then somehow it's a debate. And I think that's a problem. And to really solve it, we need both sexes engaged on it. So
thank
I look
you.
Forward to next year's panel when it's half-half. And big respect to Brad for coming here and holding down the Asian side.
I just want to thank all of you. I know this is a really full house. Every year we try to put something on the table of consequence, editorially, around White House. You know, this weekend gets critiqued as being a vapid party scene. This is a little bit like a party scene, but it is not vapid. And it's fun. I just want to say, in no particular order, first of all, thank you, Alex. Thank you to everyone out there. But a big round of applause to Jen Psaki, J. Newton Small, Lala Anthony, Stephanie Laing, Senator Shelley Moore Capito, Senator Amy Klobuchar, Hope Solo, Connie Britton, Brad Smith, Maria Teresa Kumar. Thank you to all of you. Have a great day.